give a special welcome to everyone that's here for the Multicultural Business Coalition Tour Week, as well as our friends from Liberty, Blue Springs, and Blue Springs South High Schools. So for anyone who hasn't been to 1 Million Cups before, how it's going to work is we have two presenters. Each one is going to come up and do about a 6-minute presentation about their business and their needs and their goals. And then they're going to come and sit at these couches with our expert panelists, and they're going to ask them some questions, give them some feedback. And then over here on your left side will be a microphone, and you can come as audience members and ask questions to the presenters. And if you have your phones out and handy, you can check in on the 1 Million Cups app or download it and then check in. And there you can also leave feedback for the presenters if you don't get to ask a question or don't get to come up and meet them afterwards. I want to officially welcome our new organizer, Mohammed.
My name is Mohammed Aini. I'm a student in IUMKC in Entrepreneurship and Innovation Management, and I like 1 Million Cups. I love 1 Million Cups because I get to know how businesses run, what concerns and questions people should expect when they're coming up with a business, and kind of just get to know the community in Kansas City because I really like to help out.
Have a mic, so I'm going to let them introduce themselves too.
Good morning. My name is Jenny Miller, and I am with an organization called KC SourceLink. We help people start and grow businesses by connecting them to the resources they need. If you are looking to start or grow your business, I do have contact information and resource rails in the back for you. Thank you for having me this morning.
Good morning. I'm Dwayne Lewis. I'm the owner and president of Lewis Block and Supply Company. Our core competency is hardscapes, which for those of you that may not be familiar, hardscapes are the structural components of landscape. So we do a lot of the segmental retaining walls, some of the projects, the notable projects in town, the brick pavers all the way around the Kauffman Performing Arts Center, our company put in place. On the new Lowe's Hotel, if you go down 670, there's a huge retaining wall that's about 46 feet tall that we just completed. Those are the type of projects that we are working on. And I am excited to be here because there's always something as a business owner that you can learn about operating a business. So thank you for being here. And I look forward to your questions because I'm planning to learn. Thank you.
Thank you guys so much for being here. So we're going to start off with Shanita Bryan from The Prospect.
Hi. Has everybody had coffee?
Yeah.
Come on. Okay, so I know that there's a format to this, but if you will give me a moment and let me just kind of divert, I'll tell you all about myself at the end, okay? I'll toot my own horn and tell all the wonderful things that I've done. But before I do that, I'm gonna ask you guys a question. Raise your hand if you consider yourself a foodie. Okay, that's good. There's not more people? All right, now keep your hand up if, by the simple act of having a meal, you would be willing to move Kansas City forward. Perfect. Okay, so I'm going to tell you how you can do that. But before I do that, I'm going to introduce you to a few of my friends. We have Bill, Tom, Tina, Beth, Simon. These are all people just like the rest of us who, for whatever reason, can get a job, but they can't keep the job. And they try, and society will tell you that Bill, Tom, Tina, and Beth are lazy. They don't want to work, and that's why they don't have jobs. And I'm here to tell you that that's not true. That's not why they're not working. Bill, Tom, Tina, Beth, you, me, your mama, your cousin, and all everybody else you know, we're struggling to find jobs because we have not addressed, as a group, the whole person. We have lots of workforce development programs that give people an opportunity to get training, but we don't deal with the whole person. We don't address the issues that keep them from keeping the job. So they wind up going from place to place to place to place. And if you have friends like these people, you don't even ask where they're working anymore because you have no idea. You just know they got a job somewhere. So what I'm proposing is a proven strategy. It's a 16-week culinary program that works on the whole person. We use the model of culinary to train, to teach discipline, but then we also address the life issues that keep you from working, whether it be housing, whether it be mental illness, whether it be depression, anxiety, struggling with sobriety, any of the multitude of things that come up in people's life that keep them from working. I didn't switch the slide, sorry. So this is how we do it. So the people that we're looking to help are normal people, and I don't like using the word underprivileged or poor, or because that's not always the case. They're just people who need a little extra support. And if we're all honest, raise your hand if you've been in a moment in your life where you could use a little extra support. Okay, so how we can support this is three ways. One, the restaurant and business communities. I have lots of friends who are chefs. I'm an industry insider, and they are willing to partner with me to mentor and train and develop and move people forward. And then we have the business community who can then support this business by catering, by having events there, by eating and enjoying and happy houring and doing things that you would normally do. Next, we have our prospects. I call them prospects, and I call it the prospects because I don't like the word poor. I don't like the word underprivileged. I don't like the word undeserving, because that's not the case. These people have just as much as potential as any of the rest of us. And then lastly, it's a positive economic impact on the community. We're creating jobs, we're creating synergy, and we're creating positive movement in the area. Now the difference between our program is simple. I'm gonna introduce you to my friend Bill here. Bill was a kid just like all the rest of us. He enjoyed life, playing, living, doing normal kid stuff. But Bill, in his need to survive, he made some wrong decisions. Bill wound up in prison and spent 30 years away from his community. But while he was in prison, Bill worked really hard to turn his life around. He started in the kitchen as a dishwasher, then he moved to the prep cook, then Bill was a line cook. Now all of a sudden, Bill is the kitchen manager for the prison. But guess what? Bill gets out. Now Bill is trying to reestablish himself in a community that he's been removed from for 30 years. Bill doesn't know about Google. Bill can't make Siri work. Bill doesn't know how to Lyft and Uber. He doesn't know any of those things because that stuff was not around 30 years ago when Bill was removed from his community and rehabilitated. That's who this program is for. In addition to Beth, who's depressed, and Tom, who just needs another opportunity, we have the Bills of the world who are trying to make a difference and trying to do better for themselves, but are not getting an opportunity. So let me ask you, want to know how you can help? It's easy. Support this project. We're trying to raise $200,000 to get this started. We are working with a company out of Seattle that has been doing this for 20 plus years. They have a proven strategy, and their process has a 60% graduation rate. Imagine if we could take 12 to 13 people every 16 weeks, and 60% of them graduate and go on to be mentored and move up in culinary or any other business opportunities. That would be awesome, right? Right, so that's my presentation. I talk really fast, so I'll open it up for questions.
When we're looking at your concept, who would be your competition in the Kansas City market?
I don't like to look at them as competition. I like to look at them as partners. We have a lot of existing workforce development programs, and I've talked to several of them, mainly the Full Employment Council, and they want to be a partner. So theirs might be a, you start there, and then you come to me for B, and then we support them for another year through our program until they're able to be on their own. So they're not competition. Any program that you think of in the city, whether it be the culinary program in Kansas City, Missouri School District, or Job Corps, or any of them, that we all can work together.
Okay, and my question is, you mentioned that you needed to raise $200,000 to get this off the ground. I see a very dual purpose in terms of this. I see the restaurant side of it, mm-hmm. and then there's an administrative side where you're developing
right.
your workforce. That's going to be quite a challenge. And,
right.
And I don't know the numbers. I don't know what kind of scale that you're planning on. But I think that even the administrative side will burn up $200,000 in a hurry. So I would take a really close look at it.
Right. So they call these 501c3 social enterprises, and. Obviously in 6 minutes, I can't get into every single detail of the program, but there's opportunities within the program where we're constantly raising money. One of them being every 16 weeks there's a graduation dinner. And, you know, like I said, this is a franchise, we're going to use that word, out of Seattle. And each member or franchisee handles their graduation in a different way. Most of them treat them as fundraisers. So that gives community members an opportunity to celebrate our prospects and then support the mission by purchasing a ticket and attending the graduation dinner and things like that. So it's an ongoing process. You have the revenue from the business that helps to drive, and then you have to partner. You know, we have been talking with Goodwill, we've talked to Full Employment Council, we're talking to a lot of different people to help us pull it all together. It's not something that you can do by yourself. Think of it as like a clearinghouse. It has a restaurant, it's going to have training, and then all of the additional support, we're going to bring it to them to make it easier for them to be successful. The idea is not to set up landmines in the program that make it so that people have difficulty completing it.
And I think you just touched on my next question. You were mentioning the wraparound services that you're offering. I was wondering if you're providing them yourself or if you're partnering with local organizations that already have expertise.
It's a partnership. The concept is not to reinvent the wheel. If someone else is already doing something and being effective, it doesn't make sense for me to then try to recreate what they're doing. It makes sense to pull them in because now we can serve more people. And the referral works both ways, right? They may have someone in their program that needs what I have, and I have someone who needs what they have. So we work together, hand in hand.
And then is the goal of your program to have these individuals graduate and start their own culinary businesses?
We would like to work with Square One as like a phase two to add entrepreneurship to the program. So they would do 16 weeks of culinary, and then if they wanted to, they could stay on and do 8 weeks of small business training. And then that would put them, what you said, we would bring them into the back end of the business. So then the business side, and not the restaurant side. So the idea here is side-by-side mentoring. I'm showing you, and you do, instead of me telling you to do.
Now, will they define what area they want to get into in terms of the restaurant business, or are you going to take them through each?
So the culinary training program is, because we're getting started here, ours is not ACF certified, but it's on that level. And eventually, after we establish ourselves, we will get ACF certification. Now, that's American Culinary Federation. So we would take them to a high-end culinary training. So we're not looking to train people to go and chop onions and wash dishes. We're looking to train people for that 16, 17, 18 plus dollar an hour position.
What's the market? What's the market like? You were saying.
There's hundreds of jobs in Kansas City. I have two.
Interest in culinary?
There's a lot of people who have interest in culinary. There's not a lot of effective culinary training. I have particular. participated in my previous life. Oh, I didn't toot my own horn. That's what happened. So in my previous life, I've participated in some of these other programs where I've had participants from Full Employment Council, Goodwill, and trained them. But so when you're in a for-profit business, your goals are different, right? You don't really have the time necessary to stand with someone side by side and train them. You are trying to make money, and I don't have time to watch you cut onions. I need you to cut the onions and move on.
Well, in essence, and I don't mean to hog the mic, but I get a number of my employees through the Full Employment Council and some of the job training services, and as a for-profit company, it works out well because they come pre-trained to some degree where I may spend a month trying to get them up to speed.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that strategy is the correct route to go.
Yeah, and then too, culinary teaches a level of self-discipline. And if you can get that ingrained in you, you can do anything with that discipline. I left cooking for a period of 5 years and went into financial services and sales. And the same discipline that I used to be successful in that industry is what I learned in culinary. So they don't necessarily have to be a chef.
My next question has to do with your revenue models. So you mentioned 501c3. How are you going to diversify that, and what are you looking for future funding other than a once-a-year fundraiser?
Oh, no, it's not a once-a-year fundraiser. It's an every 16-week fundraiser, and then you're going to have to talk to any and everybody. I think that anybody who's raised money, it's a spaghetti on the wall effect. Everything works and nothing works, so we'll be writing grants, looking for institutional partners, looking for private donors who support social issues, everything. Looking for individual contributors.
So strictly going after the grant fundraising aspect?
No, a mix of all that. Grants, private donors, institutional partners. Some of the partners that we work with may bring funds to the thing, and then personal relationships of our board members that will help us.
If anybody in the audience has any questions, just come on down to the mic down here. And your strategy for attracting those, for example, private donors, what's the strategy?
I'm good at throwing a party. I know how to throw a party. So that part I got.
Good morning, Chef. Thank you so much for your presentation. I think you need to toot your own horn some more.
Okay, can we flip to the next slide? Who has the clicker?
All right, you start talking it off.
Okay, so I have been in this business for 20, let's see, my son is 22, 21 years. I've been cooking professionally for 21 years, so I guess that would be what they call an industry insider. Those are my children there. Minus one, he is in college, and you know how that is, trying to get a college kid to come back and take a family picture. So I have owned and operated three businesses in Kansas City, Magnolia's on the Move, and then I've also won and participated in Cutthroat Kitchen in 2014 on Food Network. I participated in Barbecue Blitz on Food Network, and then I was featured in Ebony Magazine in 2014 as well. So. So I know how to cook and I know how to throw a party. Questions?
Thank you. In the beginning of your presentation, you articulated that there was some turnover with individuals that you would be helping. How do you know that they will stick with a 16-month program or a boot program?
Well, so in that life experience that I've had there, like I said, I've had several of these prospects as employees. And so I found myself being less of a chef and more of a life coach, where I was helping you with, you know, do you need mental health? Do you need a ride? Okay, bring your kid and I'll watch them in the office. So this model provides guided support. It's not that we train you for 16 weeks, we give you a certificate and a high five and you're on the road. You have a case manager who continues to work and follow up with you for the next year. In addition to the chef partners that we plan to work with, will have agreed to a one-year employment contract. So there's a mutual agreement. The prospect is agreeing to stay at this job for 1 year, and the chef is agreeing to keep them on for 1 year. And throughout that process, there's continued follow-up from our side and them. So we definitely go back and we check in on them and make sure that our chef partner is doing what they said and our prospect partner is doing what they're supposed to do.
So I assume that this training does have a cost. So how much does it cost for one person to go through this training? And is that what the $200,000 is going to be going towards? Scholarships?
So that part is, we're working that out. That's why we're trying to partner with the organization in Seattle. They have more of the model and the numbers for that. A lot of that is getting sponsors and working with your partner organizations. Several of the organizations that are already doing workforce development have stipends and other things available for their members, so we would be trying to partner with them and see how we can mesh all that together and make it cohesive. So that part is still coming together. It all depends on who your partners are and what your additional wraparound services will be.
All right, thank you.
If there's a person like Bill that's coming back from prison, how would they find this 16-week program?
So Bill, we plan on working with social workers, I mean everybody, parole officers. You have to get out on the street and tell people about the program. And then Bill, if he has, you know, we'd have signs up in the housing department, any and everywhere that he could possibly go. Our goal is to have some type of marketing available for him to see. And then several of the locations that we're looking for have great street visibility that we're looking at, and so there'll be lots of signage and saying what it is. So preferably he would come from a referral source, but we will figure out a system for taking people off the street.
And I have one more question. If this program is successful in Kansas City, would you seek to expand to other big cities?
So there are actually models of this. There are 59 in this country altogether, all through this same group out of Seattle. They have franchised 59 other properties. And I have the luxury of working at the program in Seattle. When I first went there and worked with them, they had two. Over the last 2 years, they've scaled to 7. So in Seattle, they have 7 properties that they're doing this at. And they specifically work with homeless, and they have so many because they have to separate children from adults. They work with kids and adults. We would try to work with people in the 18 to 30 range. Obviously, on a case-to-case basis, we could take people a little younger and people older, but our target is 18 to 30.
All right, thank you. Will these employees be full-time or contract?
So how it would work is that the first 4 weeks of the program, we just talked about this just a minute ago. I do not like the word soft skills, so we're going to call it life coaching. So the first 4 weeks is life coaching. Just everybody getting on the same page, and we're kind of getting ourselves together. This is the middle part of that. The bulk of it is culinary training in the kitchen, on the job, working. And then the last part of that is them being able to work individually as an employee in the property. So there's a give back piece to it too. We plan to have, we're depending on where we're situated in the community, will dictate what our give back is. At the property that I worked at in Seattle, they contract with all of the homeless shelters. They provide box lunches for the off times when they're not serving food.
Great. Well, you actually just kind of alluded to the question that I have, which is the urban eatery part. You haven't really spoken to that in terms of location, what that looks like, when will that be able to get started, and kind of what the purpose and maybe income.
Right.
That will come.
So the eatery part is the restaurant that they would actually work in. So there's a component of this, like I said, that's life coaching in the first half. And once you're ready and we've kind of developed our rapport and our relationship with each other, because some of the people who come into this program, there's a little mistrust, right? They've tried this, that, and the other thing, and they're feeling like, I don't know. So I think once we've established ourselves and they believe in me and they can trust in me, then they'll move on to working in the restaurant and the restaurant would run, we would like to find a property where we could run breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Reason being is we want to be able to help as many people as possible, and when you limit yourself to a certain time frame, that can automatically disqualify somebody if childcare is an issue and I'm only open during times where they struggle to have to find childcare. And then the money from that, it's a circular kind of situation where that's why they call them social enterprises. It all kind of works together. I hate the word commingle, but it's commingled.
Okay, and final question, what can we as a community do for you?
What you guys can do for me is, what is that, time, talent, and treasures? We need people who would be willing to donate their time. We need people who would like to serve on our board and donate their talent. And then we need people who are willing to donate their treasure, their money, to help us move this forward.
I'm sorry, there was one more question.
Oh, okay.
So I know you focus mainly on the culinary aspect of business here. So as you grow as a business, do you plan on like opening that up to like more business services for like the 16-week setup? Because I know you said that people can come back after 8 weeks and focus on the more business side of it, but do you plan on like opening it up more rather than just focusing on the culinary aspect?
Sure. I think that the way that this model works is that you work with the people in Seattle to dictate, to tailor the program for your city. And it's an ongoing relationship that we would have with them. So it's not like we just get our franchise, they throw me a high five and I'm like, okay girl, see you. They're with you every step of the way. It's an 18-month engagement. So as things change here and things come up, then we would make adjustments. And then culinary is a vast career. So let's just not limit it to cooking. You have food stylists, you have food chemists. There's a whole world of food that can be explored. It's just think of this as like a start. This is not an end point. This is a start. This is giving someone that extra push that they need to get started.
Thank you.
To welcome Adrian Hayes, introducing the multicultural
business coalition.
Sorry.
Good morning, everyone. What a great crowd! First, I'd like to say welcome to the students from Liberty, Blue Springs, and Blue Springs South. What great questions! Those were fantastic. Can we give them a round of applause? Happy to be on the 1 Million Cups stage, so I want to get through my notes. First, I want to say thank you to the 1 Million Cups organizing team. 1 Million Cups has been around for a long time, and they are so consistent every week, and I think sometimes that's a thankless job. So just want to say thanks to the organizing team, to the fantastic presenters today, and to our expert panelists, especially Dwayne Lewis, who is an NBC Advisory Council member, and shout out to Jenny, who's also a member of the Multicultural Business Coalition. My name is Adrian Haynes, and I'm the proud president of NBC. And what we are is we are an organization that's designed to really network the organizations that are created to support a diverse business community. We have over 30 member organizations now, and we're celebrating our fourth year. And this week, specifically, is NBC Tour Week, which is our opportunity to highlight the work of our member organizations, and we have 31 events on the calendar. As of this morning, we're almost halfway done, but if you'd like to come out for the rest of the week, you can visit our website at M, as in multicultural, mbckc.org, and if you just check the NBC Tour Week tab, the entire itinerary is there. And today, we have a lot of opportunities, including co-working here at PlexPod for the rest of the day. We'll host a conversation on opportunity zones, a conversation on how to prevent embezzlement and fraud in your business, a conversation on slanguage here at PlexPod, and then we'll wrap the night with a conversation on medical marijuana and how to engage in the business side of this emerging industry. Before I let you go, I like to do a call to action. So my challenge for you today is this, is to contribute your story to what eShip looks like here in Kansas City. We have a lot of organizations that will put out articles ranking how we are, you know, how we rate in the entrepreneurial ecosystem. Some are good, but some don't quite share the beauty of our ecosystem. So I encourage you to take a picture of yourself today while you're working your hustle and just share with the hashtag eShip looks like, because it's our opportunity to create that narrative here in Kansas City. All right, I made it through my notes. Thank you all.
And right now, please take a look at a video announcement from our friends that start with news. Take a look.
Thank you for joining us for another SLN Recap sponsored by Enterprise Bank and Trust. I'm Startland News reporter Austin Barnes. Let's take a look at this week's headlines. Momentum continues for virtual reality stress and anxiety solution Helium by StoryUp, the startup newly nominated for a Webby Award. It's a big deal for the Columbia-inflated company, says founder Sarah Hill. Helium faces opponents like NBC Universal and Nickelodeon in the best use of augmented reality category. Find out how you can vote for a winner at StartlandNews.com. Reshaping fitness for adaptive athletes, the goal of a first-of-its-kind gym by Kansas City entrepreneur Wesley Hamilton. Teaming up with CrossFit Memorial Hill, Hamilton will realize a gym friendly to athletes with disabilities. The project is expected to launch next month. Launching Duke 3D in Kansas City has been a challenge, but not one the 3D printing startup can overcome, its team says. Their solution? A new pop-up shop on the Country Club Plaza. Opening next month, Duke's team is confident the space will help them reach new customers with their photorealistic figures, a product produced using technology they say customers are interested in but aren't often exposed to. Those stories and more brought to you by Enterprise Bank and Trust. For more, we invite you to log on to StartlandNews.com 24/7 or sign up for our email list so you're always in the know.
All right. And right now, we would like Ryan to present the mug club for 1 million cups.
Okay, everybody who's been here more than 10 times, raise your hand. And if you've already received a mug, lower it. All right, so we're just going to pick somebody.
You, sir.
Tell us a little bit about yourself and why you came here today.
My name is Henri Yule. I'm a business advisor with a company called Thrive and XYP. We specialize in working with local businesses and helping them broaden their audience, saving them time in the day with business automation.
Just gonna trip over here.
And right now, I would like to present Local Legends Gaming. It is Kansas City's most versatile gaming platform, from esports all the way to mobile gaming. Please welcome Abdul Rashid.
Okay, so I know I only have 6 minutes, but let's start with having everyone stand up real quick. I need you guys to be good and awake. Can we kind of just shake out all the sleepiness? I need you guys to be interactive, because if you don't ask me questions, I'm going to ask you questions. It's going to get really awkward in here. So, go ahead and sit down. Get comfortable yet again. So, my name is Abdul Rashid Jahia. I go by Abdul. It's shorter, it's easier to get out. You're perfectly fine with calling me Abdul. And I'm here to talk about how I went from making $75,000 a year at the Federal Reserve Bank of Kansas City to quitting and getting paid to let you guys play video games. It's possible. It's definitely possible. So, my company is Local Legends Gaming. We are a mobile, a video game truck, a video game center, event space, and also an esports arena supplier in the gaming community across Kansas City as well as the Midwest. We started about 19 months ago with a mobile unit. It is a 24-foot-long, climate-controlled, and self-powered trailer that's fashioned with the latest and greatest in consoles and a premium setup, because we want to make sure that wise ones like yourself, as small as well as the little ones, enjoy playing. This unit allows us to take casual and competitive gameplay anywhere. Seeing as how we're self-powered, we can fire up by ourselves, and since we're climate control, we operate year-round. Year one, we did 57 events. Kansas City took really well to us, so we've scaled since then. Kansas City was so well to us that the city wanted us to expand to providing equipment for the conventions around the town as well. So we then moved to supplying, facilitating, and operating esports conventions. This is just a few pictures because the slide is only so big, and I don't want you guys to spend all your day reading my slides. But we've done 17 convention-grade events since our inception, and we have plenty more coming down the pipeline. As well as the conventions, December 8th, we then opened up Kansas City's largest gaming center. That focuses on esports. It's a 5,000 square foot gaming center that's actually right around the corner from this building at 39th and Main Street. Our space is three levels. Our second floor that you walk in on is a gaming center. It's always going to be a gaming center. And then our third floor is our event space. It allows us to host a slew of casual gaming events. We are open 6 days a week. The only day that we're not open is on Tuesdays, but we host all besides one of the gaming communities in Kansas City in our house for their weekly, monthly, and biannually events. Outside of the casual gaming events, we also host competitive gaming events. Every Monday we host a Smash Melee Smash Ultimate tournament. Every Wednesday we host an event called the Dojo, where we bring in players from the fighting game community, and they will train and grind out all night to get better for your weekly, monthly, and bi-monthly events. As well as I teach a course on esports. I actually bring students in and teach them how I actually monetize casual and competitive gaming so that you can actually get paid to play video games yourself or actually allow folks to play video games. It's certainly possible. I'm still here. I haven't gone back to corporate America yet, so believe me, it's possible. Just some more fun pictures of working with some of the students around the area. We partnered with some great organizations like KU Gear Up, Boys and Girls Club of Kansas City, as well as Jack and Jill, supported by some of our partners like GameStop, KC Game On, Midwest Esports, a bunch of great folks around the Midwest that support the gaming industry. We host a couple of tournament series, like I said, the Dojo. We host a series called Battle Royale where we bring you back into a space. So we although the games are internet based, we bring you back in together and let you play in a challenge for Fortnite. All the games that have a Battle Royale setting, so Fortnite, H1Z1, Call of Duty, PUBG, all of those games. And then we also do some fun stuff for those who aren't exactly gamers. We host an event called a Paint and Snack Party where we bring in little ones and their guardians and help them to express themselves through paint. We work with a local artist by the name of Deontay Thomas, and he will walk little ones as well as their guardians on how to create. We also host an event for individuals in our range called the Kickback. It's exactly what you're imagining. It's a kickback but on a larger scale. Every Thursday I bring a different DJ in from the city and they will spin while we play board games, card games, video games. It happens from 6 p.m. to 11, so we want, our idea is to help you guys decompress when you leave work or you get out of school and enjoy something that we all favor at home, but also meet new individuals. And that's generally our pricing structure. I know everybody wants to know how I'm paid to let people play video games, but from our video game truck to our gaming center, as well as our event space rental, there's a slew of different pricing structures outside of some of our partners who invest in the company, paid to advertise in front of you guys. So that's generally how the business is constructed. I'll kind of wait to the question and answer portion to go through that. So, like I said, question and answer portion. So I will hand it over to you guys to ask the questions. So you guys gotta ask questions or I'll start asking you questions and it's gonna be really awkward. So all right.
such a geek for this stuff. Believe it or not, I don't play video games, but I'm a techie and I like anything that's video oriented. You know, so that makes me an old man, I guess. This is really interesting concept. But the one thing that jumped out at me and I asked myself, or reminded myself to ask you three times during your presentation, you've got mobile trucks and then you've got brick and mortar. I would venture a guess that the mobile truck is a lot less to operate than the brick and mortar with the rent and overhead and utilities and everything that goes with it. Your pricing for both are the same. It's $350 for the first 2 hours, which means that your margins have got to be much better on the gaming truck. Why not have a mobile gaming truck service and leave the brick and mortar, unless brick and mortar is making you lots of money also?
Yeah. So I understand this question. Ideally, it is crazy, but however, so with the mobile unit, we only operate by appointment. So we then steal that exceptional gaming experience for everyone else. The brick and mortar allows individuals like the ones in this room to come in and receive the exceptional shared experiences anytime besides Tuesday because we're closed on Tuesday. But the reason that we haven't just focused on the mobile unit is because there is so many more individuals to reach. The local gaming communities, they don't just want to meet on Friday, Saturday, Sunday. They want to meet during the week. They want to connect with their companions again and play throughout the evening. With the brick and mortar, there is an exceptionally higher amount of operational costs, but the truth that it takes money to make money. So you do have to scale up your business if you want to scale up your profit. So it's risky, but we've done really well. Kansas City has been really good to us. And with us having four compartmentalized aspects of the business with the mobile unit, the event space, the gaming center, as well as operating and facilitating equipment for esports conventions, there's a synergy between the four, and they all kind of support each other.
That kind of leads into my question, looking at capacity. So you've grown quite exponentially in the past 18 months. What are your future plans, and kind of what do you as a single business owner have for capacity when you're looking at scaling this?
So our focus is currently creating a proven concept with the brick and mortar. LAN centers are a thing that were really popular about 10 to 15 years ago, but a lot of them failed in their business model because planned events are the lifeline of your business, but you have to shut down the gaming side of it. Our space is two levels, so if someone wants to come in and book the space, it operates on the second floor, and the first floor is always a gaming center. Our plan for expanding right now is scaling our game trucks. Our general focus is the Midwest. The ultimate goal of the creative industry is to build a game truck and deploy them across the Midwest. That's how this business was built. We started with the game truck so we could send it out and touch all the sub-cities in Kansas City, create community, and then drive them and pull them down to the brick and mortar. Or you would spend hundreds of thousands of dollars with Facebook and Instagram ads. So we send out this game truck, which is 24 foot long. It's ideally a billboard on wheels. So every time you drive down the highway, people see this big black truck with a golden logo on the side. They're like, what is this? And it drives that fear of missing out. We're like, hey, let me look into this. And they're like, wow, there's so much more to offer. So right now, we're designing our game truck 2.0 as well as 3.0. 2.0 will allow us to provide PC gaming anywhere, and then 3.0 will allow us to provide virtual reality up to five individuals in one truck at one time. So we'll be able to take those experiences anywhere across the Midwest. If we find out that a city doesn't like it, we hook it up to a truck and we drive it to another city. And that allows us to have a more solid, successful business model, because if a city doesn't like it, we can take it to another city that does.
And so you've got the four SKUs. What is your revenue percentage? I'm not looking for dollars, but percentage-wise, which of those four SKUs is generating the most revenue, and which of those four SKUs is generating the most margin at this point?
So The Gaming Center is only a few months old. It opened December 8th, and the worst time of the year for businesses that they have that are in the entertainment market, wintertime. No one wants to get out of their house and deal with the ridiculously long winter that Kansas City had this year. However, retrospect, the game truck is currently the most profitable product. With the game truck, our target market is going to be mothers of school-aged children and then single white men between the age of 13 and 37-year-old. We market towards mothers of school-aged children because there's that one day of the year that we all get. It's called your birthday. And we're all willing to spend whatever it takes to have a good time on our birthday. So we market to them because we are a one-stop shop. For those who have children online as well as in person, remember how many birthday parties you put on that you've been exhausted afterwards? We ideally pull our game truck up to wherever you want, and we bring in your 24-plus students into our game truck, and you get silence because we're entertaining them with video games for 2 hours. As a father of 3 kids, I will spend every last dollar for that silence. So that's ideally what we will be advertised to mothers. Not to leave out fathers, because I love everything about parenthood, but moms rock birthday parties. That's really the reality of it. Sorry, dads. It's the reality of it. And then single white men are going to be our other market because, unfortunately, there's a major gender and race disparity in esports. Actually, let's do an activity. I'm not going to leave you guys out. But since we all have these computers in our pockets called a smartphone, I want everyone to pull their phone out for a second. And people at home, open up another browser and go to Google. All right, we got a couple more seconds. I want everyone to Google LAN party. It's LAN party. So I need a break, so I promise I won't embarrass you. As soon as you see someone in a LAN party that looks like me, raise your hand. For those at home, no one's currently raising their hands. And the reason I wanted to bring up this experiment, because of the major race and gender disparity in esports, the reality of esports, you guys stop Googling, you're not gonna find it anytime soon. The reason there's such a major gender and race disparity in esports, because the reality of esports is parents of black and brown children often can't afford what's considered a competitive grade PC to play in esports. That's a PC that's built at about $2,000, $3,000. Parents, including myself, who are extremely hardworking, they can afford consoles like Xbox, PlayStation, which are still struggling to catch up with the esports industry. As well as it's a massively dominated by the male industry. A lot of toxicity online with how women are targeted in competitive gaming. It's unfortunate, but it is kind of the reality of our nation. So what I do is I create a level playing ground. I supply all of the equipment, all of the tournament structure. I allow those, no matter where you're from or financial demographic, to come into my space, train, compete, and get awarded cash prizes for doing what you want. Doing what you love at home, you can come in and get paid to play. So that's what my target, or my focus is on eliminating, is that gender and race disparity.
And everything, I understand and get everything that you're saying, but what I've heard is your margin's better on the mobile truck. You want to get out and get to people that possibly can't get to your brick and mortar. That makes perfect sense to me. If you're going to scale the mobile and be everywhere. You've got your advertising out there, as you mentioned. Not to mention, you can be in several communities, and instead of setting up the college basketball experience, for example, you can still pull the truck up outside and have a self-contained deal where you don't have employees that are dropping equipment and just the process of plugging and unplugging, tearing things up, it's costing you extra money every time you leave the building.
Yeah, so the building and the convention are also important because with everything you start, it needs to be an end game. Yeah, we can do these individual weekend events, but what are folks building up to? You have the football season wouldn't be important if there wasn't a Super Bowl. So folks want to be able to have these weekly, bi-weekly, monthly events and lead up to the compilation of it all. And we use our Game Center to be the site where we do all of that. And we cut out the events, the other event spaces like college basketball experience that has an exceptional high rate for renowned space on your event, Overmark Convention Center, Olathe Convention Center, stuff like that. We have that space, as well as it's a familiar and safe environment that you can become comfortable with attending, as well as guardians of the younger gamers can actually feel comfortable bringing their students to as well. We live stream every event, not just the gameplay, but the room as well, because a lot of folks, they love playing, but they're intimidated to come out because they don't know what they're getting into. So we're showing you that what you're coming into to continue to build the community, because that's really the heart of it all.
If you've got any questions, just come on down the mic.
Can you walk us through your process a little bit? So sitting in corporate America and deciding to take that leap, what background information did you look for? Was this originally what you were looking to do? Walk us through kind of that from, I think I want to do this, through where you are now.
So mine was a lot easier, and I use the word easy loosely because I am a father of three kids. So there was a lot of decision making and going back and forth with my wife to decide on what's right. I had a 12-year, very successful career in technology. That started my undergrad when I went to K-State. But it made it, when I say easy, because my last job was extremely, the environment was extremely toxic and I hated going to work. But the money was really good. So it was like, well, if I can get through these 8 hours, I will be fine.
Way to go through life, young man.
Yeah, but it's horrible. hair was falling out, beard was falling out. I was losing my mind. But my general focus was building the company. The reality of being in corporate America is no company cares about you. They care about the company, and they will dump on you to make sure that the company is successful. So for the last 18 months, I was a really terrible employee for the Federal Reserve Bank because I was focusing on building the company, and now I make my salary in 4 hours compared to 40 hours working for the Fed. I'm not exhausted. I don't bring very toxic energy back home, and I generally get to do this spending my time with loved ones and making new friends like my house. So this is rather easy to make that transition. I just found what my joy was. My joy is talking to people, as well as creating joy. So to circle back around, I do want to touch on something before I leave this topic. The way that you can build a business, this is free game, guys. If you make $1 million, give me 10%. But you can create a business off of selling people happiness. Anytime that you can provide someone happiness at half the effort, you can put a price tag on it. And that's generally what the business does. I take those exceptional shared experiences, like those memories of you sitting on the couch with your sibling playing Techno Super Bowl. For people my age, don't date me, guys. But I have this really great memory of playing Techno Super Bowl with my brother as a child. Some of my best gaming memories, and I ideally recreated that, and I'm putting it out to the community. But you can put a tight price tag. This is why the nation, this is why the nation has hundreds of gyms, but they still spend millions of dollars on diet bills because it's easier, and you can get it to them at half the effort.
So when you were talking about mobile trucks and going to cities, and if the city didn't like it, you could just pick up and go somewhere else. For the cities that did like it and accepted it, would you make a brick and mortar store there eventually?
I would love to. I would certainly love to. You still have to make sure you have a community to support it. So even if a city generally takes to the mobile unit, there's a couple different variations of how they take to it, whether it's Mother's School Day children with birthday parties. That's always going to be successful because, again, we all get that one day a year. But you got to have a gaming community as well as businesses that want to advertise in front of that gaming community to build up a brick and mortar. I would love to spin up a local Legends in what we consider the 12 states that comprise the Midwest. It would truly take some decision and thought process through our partners and the business.
So as I'm looking at your pictures, you have like a lot of game consoles. So would you have a option of PlayStation or Xbox in your game trucks or in your game center?
Sorry, I moved the slide really fast. So the game truck does, if you look at this bottom left-hand photo, the game truck does, 1.0 does focus on consoles. It generally carries 2 PlayStation, 2 Xbox, and 2 Nintendo Switches. So, because they are generally the easiest consoles to fire up and get going. In our next model, we will supply PCs. But yes, we do focus on having the PlayStation, Xbox, and Nintendo Switches with 4K HDR television screens.
And with you really focus on esports, and a lot of esports is mainly PC based. So in your game center, will you have PC rigs for people that want to play League of Legends or Overwatch competitively?
Yep. So spoiler alert: I haven't really told the world this yet, but I guess this is live streaming. we are currently working on building out the 1,500 square feet that make our basement to supply space for a PC build out, so we can supply gaming, casual and competitive gaming events, as well as training for games like LoL and Overwatch, etc.
All right, thank you.
With that build out, another question I had was looking at scholarship ability with esports. Is that something you would look to get into?
Yes, most certainly. So, shout out Go State. So we currently, and I can't release the name of these universities just yet, we are currently creating a pipeline for competitive players to receive scholarships into a couple of local colleges. Unfortunately for universities, you don't have to have a college degree to become a professional player, but they still want you to have that collegiate background. I see true value in it. My wife is an educator, so I have to, as well as I'm still paying on my student loan, so I really have to. But we are currently working to supply a pipeline for players like yourself to get scholarship money to go and play at a local college here in Kansas City.
Now, you mentioned for your 3.0 trucks have VR capabilities. Have you considered having VR facilities within your brick-and-mortar shop? And if so, what hurdles have been thrown your way already for that?
I have. We currently work with a really great organization by the name of Disciples of Community. They have got it mastered. They're in North Kansas City right now, who have brick-and-mortar that focuses on virtual reality. I am a firm believer of if you build your community, you build yourself up. So we currently support them in their endeavors. We do supply virtual reality in-house, as well as when we deploy it to different conventions and pop-up events. We currently just support one of our partners inside of the gaming.
Okay. Thank you.
No problem.
I have a comment, or really a tip for you about an event that's going to happen on May 2nd and 3rd here in Kansas City that I've been involved in planning. I'm a local media attorney, but I've worked nationally, and for 32 years I've been involved in planning a media and law seminar in Kansas City. And one of the sponsors is the Kansas City Metropolitan Bar Association. I'm co-chair of the planning committee this year. The panel that I've been involved in planning with a law professor and former dean of the School of Journalism, Mike Couch, is on video games. And I suggested the idea because I became aware that it was just a exploding industry and legal liabilities were exploding as well. So there will be a panel on that and three experts speaking on the legal liabilities. And one is the principal counsel of Riot Games. And it's not just for attorneys. Media attorneys from all over the country comes, but it's also for people involved in the media industry and members of the general public. There will also be panels on social media, internet trolls, and other media issues that are of interest today. And last but not least, we're going to have a local celebrity, an Academy Award-winning scriptwriter, Kevin Willman from the University of Kansas, who worked with Spike Lee on KKK Black Klansman. So I just wanted to raise that. And if you'd like to talk to me afterwards, I'm happy to talk to you about it. Or if any of you are interested in it, I can provide you more information.
Yeah, most certainly. Let's make a point to follow up on that conversation.
Okay.
the devil's advocate question, because I'm like the opposite of your demographic. I did play Little Guitar Hero with my kid like 10 years ago, but that's like the full extent of my whole gaming life. And so for those of us out here, way out here, who are like, ooh, is this really like a positive use of time for our youth, and should we spend less time on screens, and what about the addictive nature of gaming, and all of that noise is in my head, and I'm just curious if you've had to address it, or if I'm like so much a cry in the wilderness that it doesn't even enter into your